Hola, I'm Alejandra, and I'm currently a cloud evangelist at Amazon Web Services. If you were with us in the previous episode, you may remember that we talked to you about storage and the Amazon S3 service. But in today's episode, we want to talk to you a little bit more in detail about what servers have to do with virtual machines, and of course, we'll cover virtual machines in this episode. So, we explained what servers were before in a previous episode, but at this point, you're probably wondering, what the cloud is a virtual machine? A virtual machine is an emulation of a computer system. In other words, creating a computer from within a computer. It uses software instead of a physical computer to run programs and deploy apps. One or more virtual machines, guest machines, can run on a physical host machine. Now, before VMs existed, what you had was only physical hardware, servers. Do you remember how in episode 1, we explained that a server is a physical piece of hardware? So let's time travel back and let's pretend that we're about 15 or 20 years back in time and we're looking at servers from 15, 20 years ago. So this physical hardware, this server from 15, 20 years ago, definitely didn't have the same amount of storage capabilities that the servers have today. So maybe this one only had one CPU. Maybe it had 1 gig of RAM. What were you able to do back then was maybe install one application on that one server, perhaps something like a web server to host a website. But that's not really a lot of space now, is it? So servers get stored in racks in data centers. Each rack can hold several servers, and then these rack of servers are what are being stored inside of what those data centers are. If we count the amount of servers that I may have in my drawing, it isn't really that much, right? You can see that I have a constricted tablet. So let's say I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so 5 times 4 racks, that's gonna be 20 servers tops, which means if we calculate each of these pretend servers to have only the aforementioned pretend 1 gigabyte of RAM and one CPU, that means that we have enough here to maybe host up to 20 web servers or 20 applications. And again, it doesn't sound a lot, not to us, not today, but back then, that was enough, right? But what started happening? What changed, right? Well, as companies and business requirements change, 20 web servers, 20 web applications, that's no longer enough. So what do? Well, inside of your server now, instead of storing one application, you start storing 2 applications. Maybe you have 1 web server and 1 mail server. So now we have more than 1 application per server. But again, this is really not that much. So let's fast forward to maybe only 10 years ago. Hey, these servers are getting better, fancier. They don't only have 1 CPU of storage and 1 gigabyte of RAM. No, these ones have maybe 128 gigabytes of RAM and 64 CPU. So earlier we said that you had maybe 1 web server. If you were to try to put that 1 web server into your server, and then you use that entire hardware server for only 1 OS, that is operating system for that application that only needed maybe 1 CPU or 1 gigabyte of RAM, then you're effectively wasting space. Your current hardware server still has over 125 CPUs left of space. And think of the amount of waste that you're gonna be creating. Your servers would definitely are going to be wasted if you keep it up that way. So let's go back to and look at our drawing here of 4 racks of servers in our data center. Someone comes to you and says, hey, we have a new requirement now. We need to run more than 20 apps now. And from now on, we want to be able to run a minimum of 100 apps. But you know, we don't really want to increase the amount of servers. We want to be able to stick to the 20 hardware server system that we currently have because we only have enough physical space in our data center for that amount. What do? Well, you can try to convince them to get some more space and maybe buy a bigger data center, or you can start to think of how to fit 100 apps in only 20 web servers. So if we go for the last option, now we have to figure how to fit more than 1 app per web server. So this is where software segregation comes in, and it can cause a problem. Wait, I bet I know what you're thinking. You're probably thinking, Alejandra, what the cloud does software segregation mean here? Well, it's actually a splitting of a larger network into smaller networks via something that are called firewalls. One of the major advantages of such splitting is improved security for your applications. So let's get back to our drawings example. And here we have, let's say, for example, one web server and a mail server. So two applications on the same server. So what prevents them from being able to talk between each other? What happens if somebody hacks my mail server and then they read all of my emails? Ah, that would be pretty bad, especially if they were my company emails, right? So currently it looks like I have two problems. One, too many apps for the amount of physical servers that we have. And two, we are still wasting our servers because we don't need as much capacity as we currently have in these modern day servers for our just one individual app in our pretend scenario. So, enter the era of virtualization. We're getting closer to virtual machines now. Virtualization takes that physical server and splits it up. And then each one can have its own OS, operating system. So here's one OS, here's another OS, there's another OS. Ooh, now I have all kinds of apps in a single hardware server. Look at my drawing here. I have my web server, my mail server, and hey, I even have my game server here. Awesome. Okay, so this segregation here in software is a really good thing. But now you also get to have a better utilization of each individual server because you have more than one app that is running per server. So this era of virtualization that introduced VMs, virtual machines, was twofold, right? One, it allowed us to finally add software segregation between our applications, the splitting, so that they couldn't talk between each other. And again, this is really important if you want to prevent hackers. And then two, it allowed a better utilization of the resources of our servers. So now, even though we may still have only 20 servers in our data center, we do have proper segregation and we can now have, say, 3 virtual machines per server. So now that means, hey, we can have up to 60 virtual machines, right? And if we can have up to 60 virtual machines, then that means we can have up to 60 apps because we have more than one app per server. And why is that? Because we put one app per OS. We shouldn't really be putting more than one app per OS. And okay, that's good. That's really awesome. But now we have a different kind of problem. Can you guess what it is? Well, did you notice that during all of this duplication that was happening? Oh, look at this, OS, 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 so much duplication. We have 3 different OS's, operating systems here, and this is a waste of memory too. So the problem began because we were trying to fit more than one app per physical server, right? So we created all of these virtual machines, these VMs, and separated the OSs, the operating systems. But then, now, we accidentally ended up with a lot of duplicate operating systems. So we're still actually being wasteful. We definitely have better utilization now, but it's not exactly great yet. Ah, enter the era of containers. And yes, we're gonna get more into containers in episode 6, and you're probably wondering, okay, but for today, what the cloud is a container? No problem. Well, for today, all you need to know is that a container is a form of an operating system virtualization. It packages up your code and all its dependencies so that your application can run quickly and reliably from one computing environment to another. Okay, now let's back up and get back to explaining what do containers have to do with virtual machines, right? Well, containers finally allowed us to have only one operating system, and then on top of that operating system, you can have all of your apps running as containers. As you can see in our drawing here, containers now solve the next level of the utilization problem that virtual machines were originally helping improve in the past. All right, cool. So let's go ahead and briefly over to the Amazon Management Console, and let's go to the EC2 console. And now what I want to do is briefly head over to the AWS Management Console, and we're just gonna go ahead and check out the EC2 console. And if you haven't heard of this service before, The Amazon Elastic Compute Cloud, so EC2, is the Amazon Web Service, so IT resource, that you can use to create and run virtual machines in the cloud. We call these virtual machines instances. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to click on the launch button. And to launch an instance of this virtual machine, it's pretty easy. It's just 7 steps. First step is you just have to choose your Amazon machine image, AMI. Think of this as our operating system. Look at all of our options. Look at all of our flavors. We can pick from Amazon, Ubuntu, Windows, Red Hat, and more. Now, keep in mind, all of these options, all of these OSs are going to have their pros and their cons. But for today, we're going to go ahead and launch a Linux virtual machine on Amazon EC2. And this is great because it falls within the free tier usage, so you can explore all you want. Then for step 2, we're going to need to choose the size of our instance. Now remember, instances are virtual servers that run applications. We're going to keep it simple, so 1 CPU and 1 gigabyte of RAM should be more than enough for what we want to do. The size that you decide to pick for your instance type will depend on your workloads. But for today, let's go ahead and click Next. Now, we don't have to go into extreme detail for step 3 about configuring instance details. We're going to be able to configure items, adding such as an IAM role. We can do things like determine shutdown behavior. We can enable CloudWatch detailed monitoring, so logging. But again, for today, we can stick to most of the default configs and go ahead and move next to step 4, which is choosing our storage options to pick from. Again, we don't have anything crazy running today. This is just a simple little instance that we're launching. So 8 gigabytes, the default option, is more than enough. We could also add a new volume types of storage. We could determine if we wanted to delete this instance on termination. All these options are available to us. But we move on to step number 5, tags. Ah yes, metadata. For today, I'm just gonna go ahead and put name, web server, 1. I could go ahead and add another tag if I wanted to. Maybe I can call it cost center, and maybe I can make up a pretend cost center number. Really up to you. Now let's go ahead and launch onto step number 6, which is gonna be configuring our security group. Now a security group helps you add roles to allow specific traffic and how to reach your instance. For today, we're gonna go ahead and pick HTTP type, and I'm gonna pick a beautiful name for my security group. As you can see, I named it, this is a beautiful security group for my beautiful web server. And then finally, this takes us to step number 7, where we review our instance launch details and all the information. Everything looks good to go, and we click the launch button. A pop-up model at this point will ask us to select an existing key pair or to create a new one. AWS is basically saying, hey, I'm not gonna give you a username and a password for this. You're gonna need a key pair. This key pair is comprised of a public key and a private key file. I create a new key pair and I pick a name for it. I go ahead and I click the download key pair button. And what I have downloaded here is my private key. In fact, in a file format that you can see called perm format. This key pair is what will allow us later on to connect to this EC2 instance should we want to SSH into it. Now, we won't go into SSH today, but we can cover that in another episode. For today, it's go ahead time to launch our instance, and success, we have an instance launched. If we go back to all of our instances, we should be able to find the one that we just created running in the Amazon console. Wow, well, that was a lot to cover, but I hope that servers and virtual machines and their connections to the next topic of containers make a lot more sense now. All right, everybody, thank you so much for joining in this episode of What the Cloud. And in the next episode, I'll see you and talk all about containers. Bye.